I'm going to talk on how exactly a node application behaves when you run it in production, and of course it will behave here, and when it behaves here, what to take care of, what else to look at. I'm not going to bore you. If I bore you, just raise your hand and ask me to stop. Alright? So this is a basic outline of, because we are running a couple of node servers as two at DoSelect, and that's where I work. And alright, so these were the issues which we faced in the beginning when we started running Node in production. Like, when you are running it locally, everything will look good, but when you run it on production, you know, all these things will get messed up. And I'm not abusive, I'm not using any swear word here. So, it is going to be on the basic stuffs. I'm Jeff, I work at engineering team at DoSelect. You could have seen me at the booth. The first thing is logging. Like, do not do this. Like, it might look cool, like too many logs, you log everything you see, like every possible thing, and you never do this. Like, that's way too much. I'll tell you why. In general, when you look at the log levels, there are like way too much. Fatal, info, log, errors, trace, all these things. It might look really cool, you think, fine, I'll do all these things, it is like simply waste. In terms, for example, if you're running on a Linux server, two things which matters is log and error. That is two streams, standard output and standard error. These are the two streams which all these guys like, if you use Kibana, all these stuff as in for log wrapping, these things are the ones which really matters. The others doesn't really make sense. And every single log write you do, for example, consider it's a real-time server, whenever a user connects, you log this much data. It doesn't really help. Every single log is a write to either standard output or standard error stream. It's a write to a file if you're running on a Linux server. So if you keep logging way too much on scale, it might affect your performance a bit. Tricatch does exist in Node.js. I've seen like most of them doesn't use this, but of course you need to handle exceptions. I'm not going to talk about any library or any external modules which you can use. I would suggest Sentry. It's a pretty good platform to check all the exceptions. The main takeaway is you might have this tendency of logging everything. Let me log everything. It is like more information. Why not? Information is not bad, right? But resist the tendency to not to log everything. The more you log, the less you can find. For example, if you grep for some word or something, you don't really need unnecessary information, right? So do not log much. That's a key takeaway. And two things: log, error. That's it. Don't use all these other cool stuff. It might look cool, but it doesn't really work. And the basis of monitoring, of course, when you run something on production, you monitor it. The obvious things are CPU and memory, right? And your memory graph doesn't always look good. It is like, you might have seen everywhere in the graphs, like it looks like this, but in production it never looks like this. At least for Node, it will be like this and this. So don't worry about it. These are the obvious, the CPU and the memory, if you need to monitor. And you need to monitor I/O as well. IO stats, you may ask why. Can you tell me why? Why do you really want to monitor IO? Yeah, alright. Because LibUV, when you understand how exactly that node works in its code, it uses LibUV that is used for all this. So you might have heard this asynchronous IO, node is asynchronous and all this stuff. So LibUV is the one who is taking care of all these asynchronous things inside Node.js. So you really want, for example, whenever this LibUV have mapping according to the operating system. For example, if you take Linux epoll is the queue system, which is depend on OS, not on the node runtime. So whenever you make a file request or something, node just pushes to LibUV, and LibUV is the one handling all the concurrent requests to your system. So you really want to know what part of, and of course, unless you're clear using node for the sake of it, you'll use it for some purpose, right? For example, we use for our backend server for the cloud IDE, where you need to do a lot of writes and reads to the file system itself. So here, the use cases, we really need to know what exactly is the, for example, initially, you know, to start up with, we run on AWS, the micro instances with normal hard drives. But when we looked at, like, there were these many write operations and read operations, we need to move to SSD, because that is efficient, and the graphs were, like, really efficient. That's one thing. Configurations, the key takeaway is, leave all the configuration to the deployed playbooks. Do not have all these configuration mess-ups in your application because it doesn't really make sense. This is a quick thing, like quick, you know, snippet like something. So have two files, dev-config and config in your root of the application. Add dev-config to gitignode, and what the both files are the same. So so that in your local, it will try to get the dev config. If not, it will look for config. So it's a small thing. Containers, like I've seen too many guys who use containers for the heck of it. Do not do that, because unless or until you really want to optimize it. For example, if you're running it on CoreOS, you need to run it as a container, right? In that case, it makes sense. If not, just take a sip of Bud Light. It's the worst beer you can drink. And don't do that. Like, do not run anything on containers. It doesn't really make sense. And memory leaks. Of course, when you run, how many of you have faced memory leaks when running node in production? Yes. That is the obvious. Like, we have faced a lot of memory leaks because, you know, that's how it behaves. So I'll tell you how exactly when you run a node application crawl, like how exactly the memory stack looks like. So outside this RSS, that's resident set in your RAM. And except there are two main things, stack and heap. Stack is where all your primitives are, primitive data types are. And heap is where all the, all the reference data types are. For example, if there is an object which dynamically grows, it's in the stack and it's referred to the heap. And your heap is what causing the memory leak. So what happens in memory leak? So in Node.js, it's not like C, where C, you need to exclusively free your memory. Like, it's manual memory management. But in Node.js, the V8 runtime has automated memory management. So it's a garbage collector. It's a pain. It's a trade-off. But you needn't worry too much about memory management. So how it works is, so this JavaScript has prototypical inheritance. So there's a root object, and every single object is parent, and then there's root. So when garbage collector runs, it will first check for all these objects which are directly reachable from the root and is not being used. So for example, I'm not giving you an example because there is no general way you can write a Node.js application without leaking memory. Like there are following patterns, there are a lot of stuff, but anything can, for some general things like don't use global variables, like if you are using Clojure, please make sure you know what Clojure is or understand how exactly it works. If not, don't use it, because that is what it keeps referencing. It keeps referencing to something, and that thing will not be reachable by garbage collector. The collector thinks, okay, this is still being used, but it's not really being used. So that is how your graphs will look like when you have memory leak. It goes from down to up. So everyone would have seen these sort of graphs in your monitoring systems. So this is one major thing to avoid when running Node.js, and of course everyone does face it. So these are the major things. There's no standard patterns you should follow to avoid memory leaks, but and heap dump helps. So of course there should be a solution, right? So heap dump is where a dump of your heap, like the heap memory. So it is explicit. It's not binary or something. It's very explicit. It will tell you what exactly the functions are, the complex trace. So heap dump is if you're running on a Linux server, I'm pretty sure everyone does, and you have these signals. So USR2 is a signal where you can send to your process, and it will just there's a package called heap dump in npm. You can just download it. It's pretty safe because every single package you use in your node modules is your pain. It's not the package owner's pain. So this is pretty good. We have been using it. And when you just put this thing, process.onsigusr2, that's a Linux signal, just collect the garbage and put a dump a snapshot on the same folder, right? And you get into the server to kill USR and the PID of what exactly your process is. And there you get, like, whenever you start the application, do this, get a snapshot, and then after maybe, you know, 6 hours or something, do another snapshot. And when you get into Chrome profile tools, like, you can upload the snapshot and compare where exactly is this memory leak happening. It's pretty simple. When you look at it, you'll understand. And too many guys have this over-optimization, like, oh my god, I don't know, I might hit a million users now, and I'm so worried, so I put so many machines. I use auto-scaling in Node. If you have so much money, of course, you can use auto-scaling in AWS, but in general, when you have a machine, make sure you use all the resources. And if you know V8, the runtime, it's single-threaded. Node.js is single-threaded. Like, even though if you have 4-core machine, if you're just running a small node application, it will use only one core. Either one of them, but only one. It won't utilize all the 4 cores. So in that case, there are two scaling, which everyone should know, vertical and horizontal. Vertical is where using all the cores across all the cores across the machine. Horizontal is where you scale across machines, like put three, four, five more machines, and put a load balancer there. So first, scale vertically, use all the resources in your machine before adding more machines. So there is this module called cluster, which comes along with node. It's not an explicit module. Use this cluster, and what this cluster does is get the number of cores. So this OS package, with the OS package, you can get the number of CPUs your machine has, get the time, and this cluster will fork those many workers in your machine itself. So what happens is, whenever so this is a simple code. When there are workers, what it does is it check, okay, this machine has four CPUs, I spawn four processes. And this thing will automatically route and split upon those four processes. In this case, you are not missing all the other three cores. If you have four cores, in general, when you run without the cluster, it leaves you only one core. All other three is wasted. But here, since you are spawning processes on all cores, the load balance is happening inside the machine itself. Then you can, if your traffic increases, then you can add more machines and do the same there as well and put an explicit load balancer. If you want, like fine-tune things, you know HAProxy. HAProxy is a pretty good proxy where you can balance all the loads inside the machine itself. Just check it out. And so we failed this thing. So we thought we'll cluster it up, we'll use this cluster module and all this stuff. But one of our servers was a real-time server. So we use Socket I/O, right? So in that case, Socket I/O has a 7-way handshake, if you know. Like HTTP has this normal handshake, right? Socket I/O has the 7-way handshake. So what happens is, in the handshake, the first 2-3 requests were arriving in the first node. And consider we had 4 cores, we were using cluster, and all these was being load balanced inside the machine. So the handshake was hitting here, and when the handshake is done, after a while, when this core is full, is 100% utilized, the proxy was rerouting it to the next cores. So the problem was this handshake was broken. Like, because when you're making a WebSocket connection, you need to maintain that state in that core itself. When it moves, the computing will be broken. So we were just thinking, initially everything was fine because it was just hitting the first worker, core. But after a while, when traffic increased, so this was 100% utilized and started moving out and those sessions were breaking. So there's a rescue, it's pretty simple. So this is a WebSocket. So what it does is the TCP, the first, the network layer, and then on TCP and HTTP, and then the WebSocket connection is established. So after WebSocket connection is established, the benefit is headers are not transmitted, only the data is transmitted as frames. So that's the benefit of WebSockets. The problem is WebSockets handshakes might arrive at different workers. The solution is maintaining sticky session. So this is a sticky session. So for example, what you do is there is this module called sticky socket cluster, which is again I say you can use it because we have been using it in production. Do not ever use some stupid module in npm because you will regret it because when we were hitting this memory leak issue, one issue was in some other external module. And in that case, we didn't really know. I was checking, like, my code is fine, this is fine. We were taking snapshots and stuff. And in the end, we understood, okay, this is the module which is causing the issue. These are the pull requests, that's fine. So, sticky session is where, just this sticky socket cluster, it maintains this, so it has a cookie-based sticky session. So it gets a cookie, and then it will maintain, okay, if this request is coming from this cookie, go only to this worker. Do not route it to the next worker unless that session is being ended, right? In that case, that stickiness is being maintained between the core and also load balancer, or you can have a proxy or anything till the client, this complete connection section, as the session is being maintained, right? These are simple conventions which you can follow. Do not fight over semicolons or, you know, 2 spaces or 4 spaces. Doesn't make sense because it doesn't really make sense. We wrote this in GitHub user like Bender, so we wrote this conventions for Git and JavaScript. We use the standard style. If you know Feroz, he's the one who wrote the standard style, like 2 spaces, no semicolons, and all the gochas. Like gochas, you can just go through and check. And how much time left? 5 minutes. All right, good. Thank you. You can ask me questions. Anything. Of course, you should be running, right?
Hey, hi. Great talk. I myself have faced the issue with Socket I/O and sticky sessions.
Okay.
But the NPM that you mentioned that only works with Socket I/O, right?
Yeah, it works only with Socket I/O.
Yeah, and what if we want to use any transport like Engine I/O or WebSocket?
You can
check
the code of
Socket
as in the sticky socket cluster and read it to the WebSockets.
Have you ever tried browser channel? Just
browser
channel?
That.
I want to check it. Okay. It's from Google. Gmail.
Okay. That's it. Anything?
Just wondering. Have you ever had to tune GC intervals?
Yeah. So this Node. I'll answer that. So this question was, I guess, everyone heard.
Is there a way to tune the GC intervals? See,
I know there. I mean, I'm asking that we had to.
We had to. So I'll just explain that scenario. Node.js GC is very weird. It has this maximum size of 1.5 GB. In the beginning, when we were running our servers, to be honest, the server was running on 5 MB node. It was very small, but to be honest, that is what when we were running. So this Node.js GC has this thing. Until the heap's memory is 1.5 GB, that's hardcoded in the node runtime itself, it will not run the GC, right? So the tune was, if you really look at it, the GC paused. So Node.js GC has this thing. Whenever the garbage collector is running, your application is completely paused. You cannot make any requests to the application, but it was in less than 10 milliseconds. The garbage collector, whenever it is collecting, so they have this mark and sweep. Recently, Node's runtime implemented mark and sweep. So they lazily mark these memory and then sweep at the end. So it is like less than 10 milliseconds, which we really didn't need to care about. We looked at the metrics, it was less than 10 milliseconds, which is like ignorable. It's fine because it gives the automated memory handling, right? So that was it. And if you are running any application in RAM less than 1.5 GB, then you can explicitly set what is the maximum limit where the GC should run. So that's it. Don't run GC manually because doesn't really make sense. I'm not going to be an opinionated jerk here because it really depends. I've seen a lot of scenarios where people, they use Postgres and they use containers because they want to use it. Like, what is the whole point of using containers? Like, when you have a pretty good infrastructure and you really need these containers to talk to each other, and if it is really improving, for example, I hate this Docker, and the Docker recently has become more like a product and not this thing. So if you are using RKT, which is by CodeOS, then it's pretty good. It is pretty efficient, but when you run it on Docker, it is really not efficient unless you properly tune it and all these proxies and stuff inside, because Docker daemon is one big pain to deal with. So that's why I said, if you are 100% sure you can run it and maintain it, then fine. If not, it's unnecessary pain. That's it. Anything else? Every time you hear, you can tweet to me at DOLFPAX. Don't ask me what that means. And I'll be here. If you have any questions, you can ask me. Thank you.
Those interested, come to the Birds of Feather session. We'll start at 4:30. The talks